Ladies and gentlemen, for those of you who don't know me, my name is Lee Windsor. I'm the Deputy Director of the Gregg Center for the Study of War and Society. I want to thank you all for coming here tonight to this first in a series of information sessions and other kinds of events organized to help pave the way for our new arrivals in the Frederick and Oromocto area. Please bear with us. Our moderator for tonight is slightly delayed. He's to arrive any moment, Dr. George McLean. And in the meantime, I draw your attention to the notices on the table in front of you that give some idea of some of the events upcoming in the next weeks, many of them designed to help raise awareness about the practical and theoretical problems associated and issues associated with our new arrivals, and some of them involved with welcoming them and getting to know the people that plan to settle in this community. So if you'll just bear with us a couple of more moments, our moderator will arrive shortly and our formal proceedings will begin soon. Thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is George McLean, and I'm the Dean of Arts, and I'll be your moderator for the evening. Welcome to our town hall, organized by the Gregg Center for the Study of War and Society on the problem of ISIS and the Syrian Civil War. I'd like to begin this evening by recognizing that we're gathered on the traditional territory of the Wolastoqiyik First Nation. So welcome, bienvenue, and kolazi kolpa. UNB is Canada's oldest English-speaking university, and arts, the Faculty of Arts, has been part of that tradition since UNB's inception. The study of war and its effect on society remains one of humankind's most enduring programs. Now, this evening's event shows the innovative and dynamic work of the Gregg Center, which attracts such wide-ranging and inventive minds as the ones gathered here. So, to bring greetings on behalf of the University of New Brunswick, I'm pleased to invite to the podium the President and Vice Chancellor of the University of New Brunswick, Dr. Eddie Campbell.
Thank you very much, George, and a hearty welcome to everyone on a rather nice winter's evening. Feels you can see spring from where we stand right at the moment. Let me take this opportunity to express my gratitude to Cindy Brown and the rest of the rather large team that has gathered around the Gregg Center, not only for staging this event, but helping to coordinate our university's response in terms of support for the Syrian refugees who are either here or are heading our way. They've come to our beautiful province to seek a more peaceful life and a better future for themselves. And I think as we have seen communities across the country respond in ways similar to our own, in overwhelming numbers and in a myriad of heartfelt ways, from donating clothing and other urgently needed items, as well as volunteering in a large number of ways to assist the refugees. And I know that our university will be thinking hard about the refugees, and as we come to understand their needs a little bit better, we will stand ready to support them in whatever way we can. The event that we're having here tonight is important in that it helps inform us all on this critical issue that confronts, I think there's a good argument that it confronts the entire globe. Your presence here will help us understand the situation we will be in soon, understand the people who are coming our way, a little bit of their background and the very real strife and conflict that has led them to seek us out. I know that we here at the university believe that this is an important part of our job, to speak up on important issues, to have our people who know such things in front of our community to tell us what they do know. There are, as you will have seen on the tables in front of you, many more events that have been planned. I hope you are able to take advantage of them. In the meantime, I thank you all for your interest and support, and I wish you all a good evening. I know you will all learn. We will all learn something here this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Campbell. It is a pleasure to introduce our two speakers this evening. And the order of the proceedings tonight will be that there will be a presentation by each of around 20 minutes or so. and then we'll be able to open up the floor to a general question and answer period. So you'll have some opportunity to pose some questions and make some comments after the two presentations. Our speakers tonight are David Charters and Kevin Stieva. Dr. Charters is senior fellow of the Gregg Center and has recently retired as professor of military history at the University of New Brunswick. His teaching and research interests have included insurgency, terrorism, and the modern Middle East. And Captain Stieva is a chaplain in the Canadian Armed Forces, posted to CFB Gagetown. He was an infantry officer with the Royal Canadian Regiment. He studied at Brock University, Calvin Theological Seminary, and currently he's a master's student at the Gregg Center, where he's studying just war theory in Canadian military doctrine. Now, I wonder if the two of you, is there someone who would like to go first, or shall we go closest to my left and then further?
I think I'm
David is going to go first. So without further ado, Dr. David Charters.
Good evening. My brief talk this evening will focus on the sources of the Syrian refugee crisis. What I hope to do is to explain how and why the crisis occurred. Given our time limits, I'll be simplifying a very complex story rooted in Syrian and regional history. There's an expression that came out of the Northern Ireland conflict, which I think is very relevant to the Middle East, and that is that if you think you understand the situation, you've been badly briefed. I will now proceed to badly brief you. If you look at the map behind me here, the boundaries of modern Syria were defined by the European powers during and immediately after the First World War. But, and I think Kevin's going to get into this in a little more detail, the socio-cultural and religious mix of Sunni Arabs, Shia, Alawite Arabs, Kurds, Druze, and others who make up the Syrian and other regional populations, they, of course, predate the modern state by many centuries. France briefly held Syria as a League of Nations mandate from 1920 until 1945, when the country gained its independence. It had a pretty rocky start as a political state, and in 1970, Hafez al-Assad, a former Air Force officer, seized power and established a dictatorship that lasted some 30 years. When he died, his son Bashir, who was not necessarily the intended heir, succeeded him upon his death and continued to govern the country pretty much as it had been. In theory, power was divided between the majority Sunni and the minority Shia Alawite sects, of which the Assad family is a member. But in reality, power was concentrated in Assad's hands, backed by Alawite control of the military and the security services. The constitution had been suspended since the 1960s, so the Assads ruled by emergency laws, giving them unrestricted power until 2011. Before the outbreak of trouble in 2011, Syria was experiencing a demographic shift due to two things. One was the rural to urban shift, which is common to many parts of the developing world, in this case due to a prolonged drought, amongst other things, but also a youth bulge. At the time the civil war began, 50% of the Syrian population was under the age of 25, and its weakening economy could not accommodate these changes. The proximate catalyst for the civil war, of course, and the refugee crisis was the so-called Arab Spring of 2011, and its contagion effect spread to Syria via social media. The uprising began in March 2011 with a relatively minor incident in the southern city of Deraa. 15 young people painted graffiti on walls calling for the fall of the regime. They were arrested, allegedly and very likely tortured, and this sparked protests by their families, neighbors, and activists. The regime responded in the proven Assad way, and that was with brutal violence. But this did not have the desired effect this time around. Instead of being cowed into submission as had happened in the past, growing segments of the population began to mobilize. They began to organize, they mounted more protests, just as Arab peoples had done elsewhere in that region in 2011. The regime responded with more force, and by the end of the month, The cycle of protests, clashes, and regime violence had spread to every major city in the country. And this generated the first wave of refugees. In April 2011, some 5,000 people, mostly women and children, fled across the border into Lebanon. Gone a bit too far. Here we are. This slide briefly outlines the opposing forces. Note that as the regular Syrian army fractured, which it did, Assad turned first to the pro-regime militia known as the Shabiha, and then to external allies, to Iran, to the Hezbollah movement in Lebanon, and to Russia. As of right now, their intervention seems to have tipped the military balance in the regime's favor in certain areas. This was also helped by the fact that the resistance was fragmented by competing agendas. They spent as much time fighting amongst themselves as against the regime. Features of the war, of course, have included massive artillery and air bombardments of urban areas, sieges, massacres by the Shabiha, and the use of chemical weapons, all to force Syrian populations out of insurgent-held areas. Jihadist groups that joined the resistance have tended to use terrorism, particularly large-scale vehicle bombs. Together, this inflicted high civilian casualties and a massive refugee crisis. And just a few images here, some of them a little grim, but they give you a picture of the destructive capacity that's been unleashed on the Syrian population. That's white phosphorus, by the way, it burns. And those are the infamous barrel bombs being dropped from what are clearly Syrian Air Force helicopters. They're just large-scale bombs packed into a barrel. Now, this slide here provides a brief snapshot of the growing scale of the humanitarian crisis. I'm not going to go through it in detail, but between 2011 and 2015, fighting had displaced about 50% of Syria's 22 million people, either internally or externally. My colleague will say more about this a bit later, I hope. So where does the Islamic State movement fit in all of this tragedy? The history of this group is complex, again, so I'm summarizing and I'm simplifying. The first point to note is that the Islamic State movement was not indigenous to Syria. In fact, it originated in Jordan and then later flourished in Iraq under the leadership of this man, Abu Musab al-Zarqawi, a former street thug and Arab-Afghan veteran who was radicalized in prison by a radical preacher. And Zarqawi's successors were the ones who imported it into the Syrian conflict. Now, to make sense, if that's possible, of what happened later, I think it's important to explain a few key elements of jihadist thinking. Now, both Osama bin Laden of al-Qaeda and Zarqawi were what are called takfiri jihadists. That is, citing selected Quranic chapters and hadiths, which are sayings and rulings attributed to the Prophet and his closest supporters, but written long after his time. They reject the authority of existing Muslim and secular leaders. They excommunicate them, declare them apostates, and therefore legitimize their overthrow. The Takfiris want to establish Islamic states ruled by the doctrines and practices of the Quran in the fashion of the earliest Muslim lands, ultimately unifying them into a caliphate, a Muslim empire ruled by a caliph, the one acknowledged by all Muslim peoples as the supreme Muslim leader. But establishing the caliphate is not an end in itself, at least for the hardcore true believers. It would, in fact, be the prelude to the apocalyptic end of times prophesied in the hadiths and in other texts that have emerged in Islamic thought since that time. This would require a final apocalyptic battle between Islam and Rome, as it was referred to in the old days, but today meaning the West, at a place called Dabiq in northern Syria. But bin Laden and Zarqawi disagreed on how and when to achieve this. Bin Laden's approach was a little more pragmatic. one could argue he was playing the long game. Convinced that the regimes in the Middle East depended upon the United States for their survival, he believed it was essential first to remove what he called the far enemy, that is, the United States, remove them from the region. That done, the local regimes would collapse and could be replaced by Islamic states governed by Quranic principles. Only once those states were up and running and secure from outside interference could they begin to unite and create the caliphate. And bin Laden recognized that this could take decades or longer. Zarqawi rejected this approach right offhand. He was unschooled in the complex and intricate Quranic doctrines. He was also impatient and impetuous, and this brought out the bully in him. He was a man of action, and he looked at the situation in post-invasion Iraq, saw the chaos there, and saw this as an opportunity to force the pace of fulfilling the prophecy. If he and his group could defeat the U.S. and the new government in Iraq and seize power, he could proclaim an Islamic State or even a caliphate here and now. And of course, he would be the new caliph. He was released from prison in Jordan in 1999 and took a handful of his comrades to Afghanistan. There they met with al-Qaeda leaders who agreed to provide some funding so he could set up a training camp in western Afghanistan for recruits from Jordan, the Levant, the Palestinian territories, and Turkey. In 2002, after the U.S. invasion of Iraq, Zarqawi fled with his group to Iran and then to northeastern Iraq, where he took refuge amongst the Kurdish Taliban group called Ansar al-Islam. He soon took control of Ansar and created a tiny enclave ruled by rigid and supposedly Islamic rules. The Bush administration used the presence of Zarqawi's group in Iraq as one of the pretexts for its 2003 invasion, although there's no actual evidence that the regime had any contact with them because they had no control over the area in which he operated. But Zarqawi took advantage of the chaos after the invasion to put his vision into action. And the way to do that was to raise the tempo and scale of violence as soon and as fast as possible. He moved his group into Baghdad and launched his own insurgency. In August 2003, his group set off three massive suicide bombs at the Jordanian embassy, the UN compound, and at a Shia mosque in Najaf. It was that third attack that highlighted another major difference between bin Laden and Zarqawi. Bin Laden saw himself, perhaps idealistically, as trying to unify the entire community of Shia and Sunni believers. But Zarqawi's vision was sectarian. He saw the Shia as apostates. I won't go into the reasons why, but he saw them, therefore, as legitimate targets. But he also recognized that killing them in large numbers would plunge Iraq into a civil war and, in theory, advance his campaign to create an Islamic State sooner rather than later. So even though he pledged allegiance to bin Laden in 2004, renaming his group al-Qaeda in Iraq, he ramped up the level of violence, especially against the Shia, culminating in the bombing of the Samarra Mosque, the holiest Shia shrine in Iraq, in February 2006. Al-Qaeda's leaders urged him not to kill the Shia or any other Muslims because they saw it as counterproductive to their long game. But Zarqawi ignored their advice and was ruthless and brutal to any opponent and also to those Sunni tribes in Anbar province who fell under the control of his group. He inflicted his rigid Islamist code, harsh punishments, virtually enslaved their women, taxed them, and took over their smuggling routes. All of this really presaged what the Islamic State would do a few years later in Syria and then again in Iraq. But what he did in Iraq went too far. And fed up, the tribes rose up against al-Qaeda in Iraq, and with help and encouragement from the U.S. and the U.S. surge of extra forces into Iraq in 2007, they crushed the al-Qaeda in Iraq movement. Zarqawi was killed in an airstrike in 2006, and AQI was all but destroyed by 2008. However, even with a new name, a new leader, and the expertise of former regime military officers, the ISM probably would have remained dormant except for two catalytic events. The first was the U.S. withdrawal from Iraq in 2011. They no longer posed a threat to the Islamic State movement, and they provided no protection for the Sunni minority. No leverage over the Iraqi, and there was no leverage over the Iraqi government. The Iraqi government under Nouri al-Maliki then turned around and marginalized and persecuted the very Sunnis who had fought beside Iraqi and American forces to actually make it possible for him to get elected. And this drove the Sunni tribes into the arms of the Islamic State. ...2011-12 saw the creation of the al-Nusra Front in Syria, aided by two factors, the first being the Syrian government's loss of control in northern and eastern areas. Essentially, there was a vacuum, and ISM moved into and took over the ungoverned space. Now, a lot of that space was, in fact, empty. There were sort of clusters of population in cities and towns, but nonetheless, it gave them the impression that they governed quite a large area. And secondly, the regime emptied its prisons of jihadists to create infighting amongst the rebels, but also to cynically buttress its claim that it was fighting terrorism. Most of those jihadists joined either the al-Nusra Front directly or the Islamic State movement itself. And they actually ended up strengthening the movement while dividing the opposition movements even further. The ISM in Syria modeled its strategy on Zarqawis in Iraq, the use of terrorism and suicide bombers, and very powerful vehicle-borne IEDs. And the effects, of course, was dramatic escalation of violence against the regime, against rival groups, and civilians, especially Shia and other minorities. The capture of Raqqa in northern Syria in 2013 allowed ISM to establish its capital and impose a form of governance. They did provide rudimentary public services, but the emphasis was on enforcing life by Islamic, their interpretation of Islamic rules, strict observance of Islamic practices, and a ban on non-Islamic activities. But it was essentially a rule by terror. Arbitrary justice and punishments, including floggings, executions, crucifixions, throwing people, especially gays, for example, from rooftops. It was brutal. Nonetheless, the Islamic State was able to build a bit of an economic base, taxing the people under its control, imposing fines for misbehavior, looting the banks, and running a black market oil industry. This quickly made the ISM the wealthiest terrorist group in history. Very important was their social media role. Compared to Al-Qaeda, Islamic State was very media savvy, very social media savvy, and they maintained a constant and shifting online presence, showing life under IS rule, which was really intended to achieve three things. Portray the new reality that the Islamic State actually exists. Secondly, to attract recruits to it, especially foreign fighters, to join the battle and to join the state and to reinforce the state. And then finally, to terrify and demoralize its opponents. So you saw a lot of videos, as I'm sure some of you have seen, of executions. Here's a perfectly good example. In 2014, IS expanded rapidly into Iraq by exploiting Sunni tribal opposition to al-Maliki's sectarian policies. By June, Islamic State controlled much of central and western Iraq. The rapid defeat of the Iraqi army was a result of a combination of IS using conventional tactics, drawing on the expertise of former Saddam regime officers, use of suicide bombers, and psychological operations such as this image here, using social media to show mass executions of prisoners of war. And, of course, on the other side, poor morale and very bad leadership of the Iraqi army as a result of the Iraqi government's divisive sectarian policies. At the end of June, beginning of July, the Islamic State's leader and cleric, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, shown here, proclaimed restoration of the Islamic caliphate with himself as the caliph, the Muslim leader to whom all Muslims, including al-Qaeda, would owe their loyalty. So he transformed IS from a terrorist insurgent group into what might be called a proto-state. I'm one of the people who would argue that to simply refer to IS as a terrorist group is misleading. It is a functioning state, whether we like it or not. Features of the caliphate, I put up here a climate of fear, and this really comes to the heart of why we're here today, the persecution of minorities such as the Yazidis, the Shia, the Christians, and others, ethnic cleansing of groups such as the Kurds, sexual violence and enslavement of women, the execution of hostages, the destruction of shrines and artifacts, such as the blowing up of the temple at Palmyra, which I think I have a picture of here. There's the Yazidis who are fleeing from Mount Sinjar, and that's the destruction of the Palmyra temple in eastern Syria. So, by the time we get to July 2015, more than 4 million Syrians, about 20% of the pre-war population, were living in refugee camps outside Syria, three-quarters of them in Turkey and Lebanon, smaller numbers in Iraq and Jordan. For growing numbers of refugees, Turkey turned into essentially a way station for onward movement to Europe, where the Syrians joined an already large flow of refugees from Somalia, Afghanistan, Iraq, and other countries. That concludes my presentation. I finish with a bang. I hope it has given you some sense of why Syrians have been forced to become refugees, some of them arriving in our own communities. I now turn you over to my colleague, Padre Kevin Stieva, who will say more about some of the areas I've covered and some new areas which I did not.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me begin by saying it's a pleasure to be with you this evening on this subject. It's a subject that, as a military chaplain, I've been involved in since the plan sort of first started developing with the federal government to bring Syrian refugees into Canada, and the military component of engaging in that planning for their arrival and housing and so on. So I've been involved with this process for probably about 5 or 6 months now. And it's an interesting subject, and I'm happy to see the interest displayed by all of you being here this evening. What I'm going to talk to you about for the next 20 minutes or so is some of the social and cultural factors that are perhaps important to understand as we consider the arrival of the Syrian refugees in Canada. And what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to talk about some of the ethnic groups, the languages and literacy of the Syrian population. I'm going to talk about religious groups, age and gender structures within the Syrian population, some factors about urbanization and communication. And then I've just got a bunch of sort of notes at the end, some comments and observations that I've made in my work as a chaplain. Similar map to the one that Professor Charter showed you. What I want to point out on the map here is the number of the cities that are significant urban areas. We're talking about cities that have 1 million to 3.5 million people. You'll notice that most of the cities that I've mentioned here happen to be on the western edge of Syria. When during the period of the French mandate that Professor Charters mentioned, there was a move to try and segregate and colonize much of the state around the various ethnic and religious minorities. And as a result, you have the Alawis in the northwestern corner there dominating that whole region. You have the Shia in many of the urban areas, and you have the Sunni in a lot of the eastern and rural areas. And that becomes a factor as we start to talk about some of the socio-political and socio-economic conditions affecting these various groups. The ethnic mix in Syria has not changed significantly in the last 60 years or so. There have been some emigration. There has been also some forced migration of persons. But if you look at the top slide in 1958, Arabs and Kurds predominated as the ethnic groups present. The big change in 2010's data is that many of those Kurds have become Arabized. And they now are more fully ingrained into the Syrian society. They use Arab colloquial or formal as their language. Most of them are Sunni Muslim as well. And that is the largest significant difference in the time span. The other groups represented are Kurds, Turkmen, Assyrians, Armenian, Farsi. And then you have, so those are the ethnic groups, and then you have within these ethnic groups, you will have certain tribal functions and features. You'll also have religious differences. The languages, Arab is the official language, colloquial and also modern standard. Virtually everybody in the state will speak and understand colloquial Arab. Whether or not they can read and write is a different question. Kurdish, Armenian, Circassian are also languages that are spoken. There is also some ability of French and English, and the French and English competency is largely dependent on the distinction between urban and rural, but also distinction between some of the religious groups to which they belong. For instance, many of the Christian denominations are far more inclined to engage Western foreign private schooling in which a second language such as French or English is taught than many of the Muslim communities would. Literacy overall, this is based on persons aged 15 and over, is about 86%. And there is some disparity between men and women. Men have a higher rate of literacy in the state of Syria than do women as a result of their predominant engagement in business, entrepreneurship, and the requirement to read and write in order to do their work. Religious groups. This is a very brief summary of the religious groups present and how to distinguish between them, because 20 minutes would not be enough time to talk to you just about this component of the subject. The largest group are the Sunni Muslims. 74% of the population. They are Sunni Arabs, Kurds, Turkmens, Circassians, and Palestinians, all represented in that Sunni Muslim community. They are largely rural. As a result, they are also likely to be less literate, less well-off financially than many of the other groups. But they are by far and away the majority group. Then you have the Shia Muslims. In the Shia Muslims, there are four primary groups identified. There are the Imamis, the Ismailis, the Alawis, and the Druze. The Druze are not always considered part of the Shia camp. They are sometimes, by certain groups and in certain states, they're considered apostate of sort, heretic. But in Syria, the constitution recognizes them as part of the Shia community and includes them in that number. Those four groups together comprise about 16% of the population. The largest of those groups, by far, comprising about 12 or 13% of the population, are the Alawis. Significant because, as Professor Charter mentioned, the Assad family comes from the Alawi community, and Alawites have been favored and predominant in many government positions, including the military, since the 1970 coup. The third group is Christians. There are numerous denominations represented in the Christian camp. Roman and Syriac tradition. The Syriac tradition, you have Eastern Syrian and Armenian Orthodox. Amongst the Roman Catholics, you have a number of different various rites, as well as the Maronites represented in the Catholic side. There's also a number of Protestant denominations that are represented, because despite the fact that proselytizing is not illegal but frowned upon in the state, there is some missionary activity going on in Syria. The Christian community comprises about 10% of the population. Now, there are a number of other religious groups represented. For a number of years, there was a recognizable Jewish community in Aleppo and Damascus. There was an exodus in 1992. Many of them left, but there is still some component of a Jewish community present in Syria. There's also groups like the Yazidis, a religious group with roots in believed to be Zoroastrianism, that are present in the state of Syria as well, but very small, less than 1% of the population in some of these other small groups. Syria is a secular state by definition. The Ba'ath Party, which leads the government, is secular, pan-Arab, and socialist. And those are its mandates, those are its focus. The 1973 and the 2012 Constitution both guaranteed freedom of religion. The 1973 Constitution also is the one that indicated that the president had to be Muslim of some sort, which is why the Alawi family and the presidency of Assad as an Alawi, right, is supported by the Constitution. Sharia law is the main focus for legal jurisprudence in the state of Syria. But it doesn't control the public, civil, or criminal codes, which is secular by and large. So Sharia law is used for the personal, the interreligious, and the spiritual legal context of the state and its people. Many groups believe that they are disenfranchised or discriminated against as a result of the Assad family connection to the Alawite community. And that is not just other Muslim factions, but also other Christian factions. Right? And there is, in some instances, if not open persecution, certainly there is latent persecution, and there has been latent persecution against some of these groups. Some of these things are important for us to understand as we welcome people in to our community, that they're not going to be completely unfamiliar with the notion of legal statutes, of secular law. These things are not completely foreign to them. They will have some understanding of how the legal proceedings and legal precedents in Canada are established and function. Because in Syria, despite the Sharia law, secular civil law still applies and is used. Age and gender. As Professor Charter has indicated, the median age is very young, 24 years of age. You can see the data for the other groups that are the age groups that are broken down there. Significant to note is that the two most senior groups, 55 to 64 and 65 and older, comprise only 9% of the population. It's a very, very young population in Syria. That creates a number of very interesting things. Some of them Professor Charters mentioned. One of the ones that we're going to talk about a little later is the whole issue of unemployment and underemployment and the pressure that put on the state. 2015 data indicates that there is almost parity between men and women, 1.01 men for every woman. The widest gaps, however, are amongst the elderly, where women predominate in the last two categories, those 9%, women are predominate in those two age categories. Urbanization. This is just a number of statistics, most of which come from the World Bank data on Syria, some of which come from the United Nations Handbook of Nations. 58% of the population live in urban environments. This is a heavily urbanized state. Improved drinking sources, i.e. constant secure sources of water, 90% of the population, and 96% of the population have an improved sanitation system. So we're talking about a developed state with good infrastructure. Physicians and hospital beds, this is perhaps the weakest component of the statistics, 1.5 of each per thousand persons. 3% and 5% respectively of the GDP are spent on health and education. And as a benchmark, so you have some frame of reference, in Canada for the same year, we spent 10% on education, but only 6% or I'm sorry, 10% on health, but only 6% on education. So the health disparity is quite large, but the education is not that great at all. There are 29 airports, and these are airports with tarmac, paved runways. There is 96,000 kilometers of road, 63,000 of which were paved. There are 3 seaports in the Mediterranean. There are 2,000 kilometers of railways. There are 75 motor vehicles per 1,000 residents. All an indication of a fairly developed manufacturing and industrial capacity in the state. Communication. Cellular devices are common, not surprising. 87 contracts per 100 persons, which means there's a few people running around with more than one in their pocket in all likelihood. The network was fairly efficient. In many of the urban areas, it had moved to fiber optic prior to the Civil War. And up until the Civil War, there was rapid expansion into the rural areas. 60% of households possessed a satellite dish, which gave them access to Western or foreign media. 27% of the population had access to the internet in their homes. 44 television stations, 29 radio stations, and only 2 and 3 respectively, these were state controlled. The rest, right, were open source. So we're talking about a community that has broad opportunity to engage with and be influenced by Western media and by other sources of open media. You will find that this is probably more the case with many of the younger people, teenagers, people who are walking around with their iPhone in their pocket and accessing information. This also becomes a salient factor when we start talking about the ability to communicate in English as they transition into Canada. So here are some notes, some points. The greatest challenge that we're facing as we think about welcoming Syrians into our community, into Canada, will be language. I've talked to a number of volunteers who are working with the Multicultural Association of Fredericton and engaged with some of the Syrian families that have already arrived here, and they're telling me that many of the women are illiterate. Most of the men have 25 to 50 words of English, and communication is tough. Thankfully, many of the teenagers, not only did they have perhaps some English in their educational time in Syria, not only are they using an iPhone 6 and adapting well to media opportunities in North America, but while resident to the United Nations camps and the refugee camps, schools and classes were set up there and offered English, so that many of these children have had some rudimentary training already in English as they prepare to arrive and transition into a new home. Self-sufficiency, work, and contributing to the community, contributing to the well-being of others, are central tenets of being Syrian. They're central values in the state and in the people of that state. Some of it is religiously motivated. Some of it is just part of the values of neighborliness and hard work that they bring with them. The challenge that we're going to have, and the challenge that I think many European countries are currently facing, is giving these people the resources and the opportunities to get engaged, start rebuilding their lives, and becoming stable and secure citizens in their new home as quickly as they wish to do so. Because they're eager to become self-sufficient and contributing members of their new community. Although religion is in many ways a private matter, the sense of community and belonging is important. And that's regardless of whether we're talking about the Muslims or Christians or any of the other groups. It's important for us to recognize that having left their family back in Syria, having left their comfort area back in Syria, having left their communities back there, the family network that they bring with them, and a community, whether it's a Syrian association or whether it's the Fredericton Islamic Association or the Armenian Church of Canada or whatever it is, these agencies are going to provide a context for finding community and helping them get settled in more quickly and feel a sense of community and belonging and support. Muslim women may be challenged in a lot of the ways in which they are asked to engage as they come into our society, because modesty plays a big role in their interaction with care workers, support workers, medical staff. They may be challenged more than any other group with how this interaction happens and finding appropriate persons to liaise with and seek assistance from. Access to traditional foods. especially halal foods, is difficult. Costs are prohibitive, and understanding exactly what is halal and what isn't is difficult. Not only, halal doesn't just refer to the fact that they can't eat pork. Halal refers to a whole range of foods that are considered haram, not permitted. And it also has implications with regards to preparation, not only in the packaging and preparation in a manufacturing context, but preparation at home and storage. Right? So all of these things become important factors when we start helping residents, new residents into New Brunswick, do grocery shopping, find out where they can find food that is appropriate to eat, and helping them wrestle with the packaging and the labeling on the products that they're considering purchasing. One of the interesting things is that in many ways, products that we would look at as easy fixes, like Campbell's soup, will in some cases be considered haram because it's a combination of vegetables, broth, and meat which has not been properly prepared, and it's packaged together and it is not to be consumed. So we wrestle with a lot of those religious cultural issues as we bring new families into our communities. The same can be true for the issue of clothing. Dress and clothing potentially presents a real challenge, not just for women in a Muslim community, but for men and women, because there are rules around hijab that influence both. And hijab is often used to refer to the headscarf that the women wear, but more broadly, it refers to a code of modesty. And it's about modesty. And as a result, there are some clothes that are offered to them, perhaps free, will be inappropriate and not, they won't feel comfortable wearing them. There are issues with regards to covering of the head and neck for women if they wear a hijab. The Quran talks about the apparent parts, the face and the hands, as being the parts that are necessary for communication and interaction in a social environment. But for men, you will find that even they have restrictions, and they will shy away from stuff that perhaps is very Western or too showy or flashy. Right? Bright colors and so on will be deemed inappropriate and undesirable because it becomes part of the cultural norm and a sense of modesty that influences men and women in their culture. So these are just some of the issues that we're going to be dealing with as we bring these Syrian families into our communities and as we engage them and attempt to help them settle, help them find the resources they need, and become comfortable in our community. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kevin, and thank you, David, as well. I think we've had a very good overview of both the historical context and also the socio-cultural aspects that are facing us and facing our community as we address this issue. We do have an opportunity now for some questions and some comments from our assembled guests. We have three microphones on each of the stairwells. Watch out, one is spring-loaded, as we discovered a few minutes ago. They might all be trick microphones, but I would ask you, if you have a question or a comment, please come to the microphone so we can hear you. We'd ask that you let us know who you are, and if you would, keep your question or your comment brief. And I guess I'll be the judge of what brief means in this respect. But we would like to hear your comments, and that will give us an opportunity to have a bit of an exchange of views with our panel guests this evening. So, who would like to go first with a question or comment from the floor? Please, Elizabeth.
Yeah,
It doesn't trust the spring loaded. And that right in the center there is a button that you can turn on.
Elizabeth Mankey from the History Department. And I have a question for David. Before ISIS became dominant in Syria, how much of the population would you estimate was openly opposed to the Assad regime? And to what extent has the emergence of ISIS as a major power actually made people flee or, you know, change that configuration?
Thanks, Elizabeth. I'm not sure I can give you a hard and fast figure on how big the resistance was. It ran into the thousands, but we're probably talking a few tens of thousands. A lot of people, their resistance was simply to flee whatever was going on, and they were fleeing not only from the regime but from the violence that was also being done by the other side. So I would say an awful lot of people were unhappy with the regime. We know, for example, that in the immediate outbreak of the uprising in 2011, that people took to the streets in hundreds of thousands. How many of those went into an armed opposition? Probably only a fraction of them. I mean, none of the resistance groups was very big, and they ended up fracturing and fighting with each other, all of them numbering in the small thousands. So a lot of people, their opposition was expressed initially in the streets and then simply by fleeing the regime. To answer the second part of your question, the largest number of refugees had fled before ISIS became a big factor. But they did, when they did begin to assert their power in Syria and Iraq, more people fled, like about 500,000 Kurds did, for example, and they'd stayed in place up to that point. The Yazidis did. So they added to what was already a pretty large refugee problem, but they weren't necessarily the largest response that came from the war, civil war.
Thank you. Who'd like to go next? Perhaps I'll ask a question then to keep the discussion going. It's been said, and perhaps I'll direct this one to David, a broader question about the scenario and the situation in the Middle East, and particularly with regard to fears of terrorism emanating from that region. Often in media, in public opinion, there's often the view put forward that terror is directed towards the West, that, you know, it's the George Bush, you know, they're enemies of our values. And more recently, there have been a number of arguments that this is actually not the case at all, that it's a misdirected argument. It has nothing really to do with the West other than the West placement, and it has more to do with the type of struggles and the conflicts that you've described within the region itself. Is there something to that argument that maybe it's not all about us, I suppose?
Yes, I'd say that's quite correct. It is not all about us. There's a number of debates going on amongst the scholars who look at these conflicts as to, you know, what is really driving them. There's one school of thought which argues that, in fact, what we're seeing, not just in Iraq and Syria, but across the region, is a kind of a struggle for power within the Islamic community as to how Islam itself will be defined in years to come. So it's a struggle really over control of an idea and over a community. There is another school of thought that argues that it's a struggle for power between Al-Qaeda and ISIS at the moment as to which one is actually going to lead the jihadist movement in whatever direction it chooses to go in the region. And there's debate as to which one is really the more serious and the greater threat, if you like. We have to remember, I think, that the largest number of people who have been killed by either Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State, are in fact Muslims and Arabs, not Westerners. Terrorism in the West has been relatively rare. I mean, we had obviously the horrendous event of 9/11. Nothing since has ever come close to that. Will we see more of it? Probably, but quite frankly, it's probably a sideshow.
Thank you, David. Allow opportunity for someone else to jump in, please.
Hi, thank you to you all for hosting and presenting. My name is Kate Schlepper. I'm a grad student in the biology department. And just, I don't want to be black and white about it, but looking at the news, it's striking to me the difference in public and political reaction in Canada versus the US. And I'm wondering if you think the support that we're seeing in Canada by the public and the government is sustainable, not just, you know, for the next couple months as refugees come in, but for the years to come as people settle, and what, where's the drive for the support coming from?
Kevin, would you like to take the lead on that?
Sure. I would agree with you, Kate. There's very much a difference between the perceived reception and hospitality being extended in Canada from much of what we read in the news about the animosity, the fear that's being generated in the United States with the prospect of Syrian refugees entering the United States. I think by and large, the Canadian response is in part supported by the immigrant nature of our own society and our own communities in many respects. The Daily Gleaner this morning had an article about a woman who was volunteering with one of the Syrian refugee families, whose grandfather or great-grandfather himself was a Syrian refugee who had immigrated to Canada a number of years ago. And there's that sort of connectivity, I think, that perhaps sets the groundwork for a much different response, because in many of our pasts, there is an immigrant past that's not that distant. I think one of the other things that perhaps conditions our response is events and forums like this, where we have people who are intent on becoming educated, who are intent on doing research to find out exactly what the nature is of the people who are arriving, and realizing that in many respects they're not that different than any of us. And you know, we have, I think as humans we have a latent trend to be suspicious of anything we don't know. There's an element of fear in the unknown, and the way to make sure that that doesn't creep up is to continue being educated, to continue understanding the dynamic of what's happening, and being involved. I think those are the keys to continuing the response that's begun.
Anything you'd like to add, David, or should we? Yeah.
Just one or two thoughts, and that is that I think we have to recognize that in the United States, the issue of immigration, particularly what they call illegal immigration, had been a very heavily politicized issue long before the Syrian refugee issue came on the table. So there's kind of almost an issue, a problem of timing, that they've arrived on the scene, if you like, at a time when in the United States the word immigrant and immigration is a bad word politically. And people have deliberately politicized the issue that had happened before the Syrian crisis emerged.
Now, over here, in front of the very bright lights, I see an imposing silhouette. I think I recognize the silhouette. I think it's Mark Milner, the director of the Gregg Center. So,
thank you.
Mark, am I right? Sounds
Mark
like him,
Milner,
too.
I work at the Gregg Center with David and the History Department with Elizabeth, so it's not a planted question. But I'm interested if Kevin maybe would address this. You described essentially virtually an almost secular society that's divided along religious lines. And the sense I get from the media I hear is that Syria was a very tolerant society. It was a functioning society, that religion was very much a private issue, but the street was public and the street was secular. You know, a lot of the fear in the West, I guess, is about the more extreme elements of Islam, particularly Islamic State coming here. But I don't think that's who we're getting, and people need to be reminded of that. Can you say something about whether that... what we're hearing about the kind of peaceful coexistence, cooperation, tolerance that seems to be evident in Syria before the outbreak of the civil war is actually true?
Sure. Thanks for the question, Mark. Absolutely. As I mentioned in the presentation briefly, the 73 and 2012 constitutions both guaranteed freedom of religion. And religion was very much a private, familial matter. And the sense of community within the religious community was one thing, but the sense of community in the street on which you lived was tolerant, diverse, and you would have any number of different religious groups being represented in the same enclaves, the same communities, and interacting with each other in most of their daily business activities, school, shopping, work, and so on. And that is, I think, reflective of the fact that all of these religious traditions, in many respects, hold many of the same values and have many of the same goals for their adherents. They're looking for, you know, spiritual maturity. They're looking for an aspect of charity and giving back to their communities. There's a context of prayer and service. All of these sorts of values, I think, contribute to a community that, in its diversity, can continue to function and be tolerant and be supportive of one another. And those same values are being transported with the people who are coming to Canada as refugees, because those religious values, those communal values, don't change with the change in location.
Thank you. Sir.
My name is Joe Rideout, and I think my question might be directed towards David. We haven't heard a lot about the Kurds this evening, but from a Canadian perspective, our involvement over there militarily has been, with the exception of the bombing, almost exclusively in the training of Kurdish forces in the northern part of the country. And I wonder what our expectations might be if that were to continue or expand it, whether the Kurds could eventually control a part of northern Syria and Iraq, and keeping in mind their traditional animosity, shall we say, between them and the Turks, and what's the potential for a sort of a zone, a military zone there being accomplished through continued efforts of that nature?
Thanks for the question, Joe. It's a good one and it's an important one. I think we have to, again, kind of set this in its historical context a little bit. When I taught my Middle East courses, I usually started the first lecture with a question for my students: where's Kurdistan? And most of them said, what? Who? What? Who? Where? Where? And I would point out to them that Kurdistan, or what could be Kurdistan, existed in parts of Syria, Iraq, Iran, and Turkey. Really since, I suppose, the 70s, the Kurds have allied themselves or ended up fighting against any regime that would give them an opportunity to find a way to begin to carve out a piece of territory for themselves. Because they would argue, just like anybody else, we are a definable national ethnic group. We know we've had some degree of independence in the past, and we want to restore it. So this process of trying to carve out a piece of ground that could be known in the future as Kurdistan is a process that's been going on for at least decades, if not longer. At the end of the 1991 Gulf War, the regime, of course, the Saddam Hussein regime had attacked the Kurds up in the northern part of Iraq. And one of the decisions that was made after the 91 war was that that area would be protected and would become essentially almost quasi-independent. And it was protected under a UN resolution by American and British and other air power. And that, I think, was a turning point for the Kurds, because it essentially meant that they had an autonomous area under their own control, and that And that, I think, really gave them a sense that they were beginning to become masters of their own destiny. What's happened since, of course, is that they have been able to, over several decades, kind of build this quasi-state, a proto-state, if you like. I wouldn't call it a fully functioning nation state yet, but it's getting there. And the civil war in Iraq and then in Syria has given them an opportunity to move themselves forward in beginning to carve that state out in a more concrete way. But of course, there's been tremendous obstacles to that as well. Islamic State movement was an obstacle to it, and then, as you pointed out, Turkey. Turkey, for a whole variety of reasons I won't go into, has had a big issue with some of its major minority groups, the Kurds amongst them. The Kurds, or the Turks, really are not comfortable with the idea that an independent Kurdistan would come into existence, because it would mean probably ceding part of their own territory in the east. So are they there yet? No. Are they on the road to statehood? I would say yes, but it's probably still a long way off. Does that answer your question?
Thank you. Over here.
Hi, my name's Patricia Forrestel, and I was just wondering, the dynamic between men and women in Syria is obviously very different than in North America, and I was just wondering how that will affect them adapting to Western society.
Question.
That's a good question. I think for many of the Syrian refugees that are arriving, Patricia, women will face the greatest challenges in the transition to our culture, our world. The dynamics that are present affect not only their role in families and society more broadly, because in Syria, many women, especially Muslim women, would be at home. They would take care of the families. They would be the matriarch in a household. They will have little exposure or little involvement in a business orientation unless it's a cottage industry of some sort. There's also the issues of dress code, and there's a sense in which women who choose to wear the traditional garb stand out. And there's a component of being different than the community in which you're trying to assimilate. I think some of those issues have as much to do with our perception and the way in which we respond to those people as they come into our communities as they have anything to do realistically with the clothes that they choose to wear, the religious practices that they choose to adhere to. But clearly, as I mentioned in the briefing, issues of modesty, issues of working and integrating with male support workers, medical staff, many of these challenges confront all of the refugees entering, but particularly for women, by virtue of some of the religious tenets, become a real challenge.
If I can tag on to Patricia's question, because it's an excellent one, maybe Kevin, you could talk a little bit about perhaps some of the challenges that exist in a smaller city, in a smaller populated province like New Brunswick, with regard to some of the refugees arriving in Canada. Are there distinctive things that, in your expertise and your experience in preparing, present unique issues or perhaps circumstances for smaller communities as opposed to some of the larger cities where it might seem more natural with local communities of existing members of those populations?
Absolutely. I think you hit the nail on the head right there. For a smaller community like Fredericton, one of the challenges is that we do not have an active or perhaps even a visible Syrian community already established and present. We have the Fredericton Islamic Association, which provides support to the Muslim community, but it is fairly small. In the broader province of New Brunswick, you will have there's an Islamic Association in St. John. There's resources available in Moncton, but it's fairly limited. Mm-hmm. And some of the challenges that we're confronting is access to halal foods in our community. because there's just not that much demand for it, and it becomes difficult to find. It's cost prohibitive by virtue of the fact that we don't have that much of it coming in. Finding clothing that is suitable for women who choose to wear traditional garb. And that's the Muslim community, because then we're also talking about other communities, such as, for instance, the Armenian Orthodox or the Eastern Orthodox. And the only Armenian the nearest Armenian Orthodox church to New Brunswick is in Montreal, which is a long way, and I think explains in part why you will have some of these minority groups tending towards the larger urban centers like Montreal, Toronto, Vancouver, because there is a community, either ethnic or religious, that they can find some support and connectivity to more easily.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Alex Landine, and I'm a student in the Faculty of Arts. I'm in the undergraduate program. And I was wondering, it's sort of an extension of the previous two questions, in terms of Syrian families with children. I know you mentioned that it's a very young population, and I've noticed that a lot of families who have been coming to our community tend to have 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 children, and so very big families. And I was wondering if you've noticed any differences or cultural practices that might be something you wouldn't expect with, or not how we interact with Canadian children. Are there things that might seem inappropriate that would be fine in traditional Canadian ways of having kids at camps or school programs or things like that? Anything that Canadians should be aware of as they welcome Syrian families and their children?
I'm not certain that I can speak specifically to some of those issues. I think in any context, you will be dealing with a sort of the culture shock of coming into Canada. You'll be dealing with the language barrier that even children who have some rudimentary English are going to experience a language barrier. There's also going to be a fair amount of, for the children, trying to understand and come to terms with the decisions that their parents are making and some of the challenges being confronted with regards to, you know, clothing, food, peer groups, sense of belonging to a community, and so on. And many of these things will be dependent on how well the parents adjust and how well the parents respond and what compromises and decisions they make as they begin that integration process, because the children are in many ways dependent. Obviously, schooling is going to be a big challenge, and I think in all of these contexts, the best that we can do as we engage with the young children is to ask, be genuine, and give them the time that they need to settle in and become comfortable.
Thanks, Alex. Other questions? I think I see someone making their way.
Hi, my name is Sharon Weaver. Dr. Charters, you mentioned that much of the, or some of the rural to urban movement was driven by drought. Can you speak to the issue of climate change in the whole mix of the refugee crisis and the movement of peoples?
I'll have to start off by saying I'm not an expert on that. So it's my sense that that Syria provides, if you like, a microcosm window, if you like, onto a larger problem of climate change and population movements. Because I don't think we're seeing it limited to Syria. I don't even know that much about the Syrian situation myself, except to acknowledge that it's one of the factors that was moving people from rural to urban areas. But if you look at other countries, Somalia, for example, some of the sub-Saharan African countries, if you like, things like deforestation and so on, drought, prolonged droughts, recurring droughts, seems to be having an impact on the movement of people. That tends to shift people either into urban areas or into coastal areas. usually into parts of countries which don't have the infrastructure to absorb them, to employ them, to support them and sustain them. Beyond that, I don't think I could really give you a much better answer. Sorry, Sharon, that's best I can do.
Oh, that's good. Thank you.
It's a good question. You've stumped him, Tucker. We'll move over here, and then we'll go to the center.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Aisha, and I'm from UNB Engineering. I have a question about, I heard in the news that they're still recruiting people into ISIS, and what encourages those people to join ISIS? Because I came from Southeast Asia, and there are still people from my country that join ISIS right now. So there must be something that encouraged them to join. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that question. It's the for those who are studying that movement, it is the $64,000 question. Why do people join it? And there are full books and many essays and articles being written about it. And to be honest, there's no, pardon me, no consensus on finding, say, any one driving factor that causes people to join a movement like that, a particularly movement which has done some of the things that I've discussed this evening. For some, let me say that there is no, the one thing that they have agreed on is that there is no single profile of recruitment. We can't point to one single path and say this is the reason, this is the process by which people join the Islamic State movement, or these are the people who always join the Islamic State movement. There was a tendency, I think, in the earliest points of time when people were looking at this and saying, oh, well, we must understand that these are people who've been marginalized in Western society, for example. They're excluded. They may be high school dropouts. They may have encountered discrimination and so on. The problem is the evidence doesn't support that. The movement draws from a broad base of people. There's one, I think it's a Canadian, who gave up a very well-paying job. I think he was getting paid better than I was as a professor, and was not marginalized in any sense. He was fully integrated into his community, but chose to leave it and join the Islamic State movement. Why? I don't know, because I don't think he's come back yet. Most of the recruits tend to be fairly young, so we're talking about people who are impressionable. Most of them are male, but not exclusively so. ISIS has been increasingly attracting young women as well. Some of the people do have social issues or cultural issues. Some of them may have been in a marginalized community. But there's no single profile. There's no map that tells us if this person starts here, they're going to end up there. We simply don't know. Each case seems to be unique and distinct in and of itself. Occasionally, you'll get little clusters, two or three guys who maybe know each other, and maybe they talk themselves into it, and they spend a lot of time on the net, and they get attracted to it. There was one case which was described in, I think, in one of the books I was reading, where the young man in question had spent 14 hours a day trolling jihadist websites. Maybe this was a case where, if you like, a parent had realized what was going on, intervened, there might have been some way of dissuading this person. To some extent, the kind of people who join these groups are not all that different from those who have joined similar groups in other periods, of time. If you go back and look at, say, even the FLQ in Canada, the age profile is similar. The demographic is similar. It's mostly young men. But then if you look at ISIS and, pardon me, Al-Qaeda, they're not all young. There are other groups that I can think of, terrorist groups that emerged throughout the last few decades, that were built around family connections. So my answer is probably going to seem like a bit of a cop-out to you, but I can't give you a single reason why, a single reason that we could nail down and say they've joined this movement for this reason. It seems to be individual. Some are attracted to adventure. Some may be attracted because they're dissatisfied. Some may feel some kind of religious inspiration. The answer is I can't give you a solid answer.
Aisha's question is so fascinating. You know, the American analyst and observer of terrorism, Gerald Post, once said that for a terrorist to give up terrorism is to give up his reason for being. And the comment behind that was that there's a psychological switch that an individual makes to adopt terrorism as a political instrument. And it's interesting because Gerald Post makes an argument in the same piece that, in fact, terrorism is an immensely effective political instrument as a way of binding together those who have that sort of common view of disillusionment with the political structures that exist in the day, and a sense that the only way to bring about political change is, in fact, to smash those political structures and to build up something different. And then those individuals who are disillusioned look for the larger group, and that larger group then forms, you know, what we see today. I think David's point, though, that trying to find an identifiable single item is almost impossible, because there's a psychology there. There's something ideologically pinned in an individual which becomes their reason for being. His point, by the way, I'm taking too much time, but his point, I think, is that to remove that reason for moving ahead with terrorism would be to remove their reason for being is in effect suggesting that to turn to an ideology of terrorism, you know, a blunt instrument, a political instrument using terror and violence against innocents, to get to that point is almost impossible to move back from, which should come as something of a comfort to those of us in the room, because we'd all agree that that's something that we couldn't identify with, but it makes it even more difficult. There, I've exercised enough of my role.
Oh, he's I'm going to add, I'm not going to dispute anything you've said, but simply to add to it and say that, you know, we do have historical precedents. We have seen people join extreme movements in the past, whether it was joining the Bolsheviks and the communists and the Comintern and so on in the 20s and 30s, going off to fight in the Spanish Civil War, for example. People who joined the Nazi movements and all of its associated movements in Europe. There was something about that suddenly appealed to somebody, and usually probably at some kind of sort of gut level. Some of it may be a sense that you're joining a historically significant event and movement, that you have a chance, it kind of empowers you to change history. That's a bit of a soft argument, but I think if you look at people who joined what today we would look back on and say were extreme movements of their time, we might see some echoes of what we're seeing amongst the people who join ISIS today.
We have about 10 minutes extra due to my tardiness. So what I'd like to do is to entertain the last two questions here, and then we'll wrap things up, and there'll be a bit of a gathering afterwards. So I think you're next, sir.
Yeah, my name's Doug, and I'm the guy who tipped over the microphone. So didn't mean to do that. When I look at the map, I see Jordan and Lebanon right there. What's going to keep ISIS from sweeping into those countries other than military?
That's a question that's exercising King Abdullah of Jordan on a daily basis. In fact, it's almost a miracle that ISIS has not had a high-profile, successful attack inside Jordan. The Jordanians have prevented a couple, but they had, when was it, in 2006, there was an attack, I think, on a hotel in Amman, which resulted in, I think it was about 60 deaths. Apart from that, there haven't been many, but the only thing I think that's keeping ISIS out is that they are fairly fully preoccupied at the moment with fighting to hold on to what they've gained in Iraq and Syria. And that they've drawn, I think, most of the Jordanians or others from inside Jordan who would perhaps pose a threat to the Jordanian regime, the Jordanian society, are already engaged in places like Iraq and Syria, and a lot of them are dying and perhaps not coming back. Is that always going to be the case? I wouldn't want to hazard a guess and say yes. I think Jordan definitely feels under threat. Lebanon, likewise. Lebanon has been perhaps the most, I won't say abused state, but it has been a battleground amongst its neighbors for decades. The Palestinians, the Israelis, the Syrians have all played a role in shaping and reshaping the Lebanese state, and not always in a very pleasant way. So the Lebanese are very concerned. Right now, 20% of the Lebanese population is made up of Syrian refugees. And the last time they had that big of a demographic shift, it helped to lead to the Lebanese civil war in the mid-70s. So the Lebanese are very concerned that this whole thing will spill over into them. I suspect that in some ways that's why they're kind of hoping that that either a peace agreement can be reached or that perhaps the Assad regime will succeed in stabilizing the country and the people will simply leave Lebanon and go back and rebuild their homes there, back in Syria. But yeah, Lebanon teeters on the brink, just as Jordan does.
I have a follow-on portion of that question, if I may, because one of the things that I would have thought perhaps was an influence or a factor in that is the presence of Israel, who have very, very direct concerns about both Jordan and Lebanon, and any incursion into those might actually bring the Israelis into the mix. Is that?
Yeah, I mean, it's very interesting that, in fact, Israel has kept its head down through pretty much all the way throughout this, trying to avoid essentially attracting attention to itself. But I think I think Kevin's right. If the Jordanian regime was threatened, if Jordanian society looked like it was going to descend into the kind of chaos that has possessed Syria and could sweep Lebanon, I think the Israelis would come to the rescue of the Jordanian king, which would be one of the great ironies of modern Middle East politics. The Israelis take the ISIS problem very seriously, but I don't think they feel they have the means to deal with it appropriately at this point, since at this stage they have not been directly confronted. Will that always be the case? I don't know.
Thank you, and thank you, Doug. We'll turn to you for our final question or comment.
Yeah, it's both. Marcelo Santos from engineering. Well, building on the question that Aisha made in terms of the driving force behind all these guys joining ISIS and other Islamic terror groups, I mean, you the table explore well the mechanics of that may occur, but isn't it the fundamental issue a ideological one? Like you talked about the revolutionary people that want to implement socialism, for example, they have they may be attracted by different reasons, but the underlying ideology is the same. So isn't this case that the underlying ideology is a Salafi Islam, and the idea that all these young Muslims they end up attracted in the sense of they want to imitate the early Salafis, the early followers of the Islamic Prophet, and even imitating things that happened in Arabia at that time, like beheadings and the burnings, etc., that were part of the tradition of the Islamic Prophet Muhammad. But that, I mean, I take that as something that happened in Arabia 7th century. But then these guys want to replicate. So the question is, isn't Salafi Islam the underlying ideology behind that? And if the answer is yes, is this conflict much more ideological than military, because you can actually defeat ISIS, but the ideology, Salaf Islam, is still going to be present and is still going to be attracting people.
There's a lot packed in there. Who wants to unpack it?
I'll give it a shot to start, Marcello, but I'm not sure I've got a good answer for you. First of all, I would say we have to draw some distinctions And here this gets way into deep theological waters, which I'm not entirely comfortable with, to sort of attribute all of it to Salafi Islam is probably a mistake. That's why I use the term takfiri, because that is a distinct force within Salafist Islam. In fact, I would argue that, in fact, it draws more heavily from the Wahhabist tradition, which emerged in the late 18th century in Eastern Arabia and became the essentially ideological underpinnings of the Saud regime. But your basic question is, are they being drawn to this, whatever, however we describe it, are they being drawn to this by the appeal to some kind of idealized past, a past that supposedly existed at the time of the Prophet and in the immediate aftermath? And yes, I would say to some extent, some of them perhaps believe that. Certainly Zarqawi, even though he had an uneducated understanding of Islamic history, but perhaps more so Maqdisi, who was his spiritual guide, they were steeped in this. Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the current leader of ISIS, did in fact a doctoral degree in Islamic history. So he understands the finely tuned nuances of the ideology. Is it the ideology that's attracting these people to join, whether they're people from the region or foreigners? Comes back to what I said earlier. I don't think we can point to any one factor and say, yes, this is what's drawing them in. Ideology, if we want to call it that, a politicized religion might be part of it. I don't think it's the only explanation. We have to look at things like home life, education, social integration in society. What is it that draws particularly young men to a life of adventure and danger? I mean, think, you know, perhaps of your own past and so on. Are there things you did when you were 18 to 24 which you wouldn't even dream of doing today? Probably. It's a big thing with guys. I'll tell you something. There aren't a lot of 50-year-old terrorists. Most of them are either dead or retired by that time. The profile of terrorist groups tends to be guys 18 to 24. What does that tell you? A lot of testosterone at work there. You know, I'm being a little bit facetious here, but you know, we do know that that's the major group you can identify. These are guys who perhaps, if left on their own in other circumstances, they might be involved in street gangs, they might be involved in the drug trade, they might be doing something foolish like skydiving or driving race cars. You know, there's all sorts of things that drive individuals to do certain things, and I don't think we can put it in a single box and say, this is it, we've figured out the formula, and there it is, and these guys are going to become jihadi terrorists.
When we have the chance, make sure you ask David about race cars. But I'll turn this over to Kevin.
I guess my only comment would be, whether we talk about Salafism or Wahhabism, I think it's important for us to recognize, given the nature of what it is we're here for, as we're talking about the arrival of Syrians, many of them Muslim, into our communities, that in each of these cases we're talking about an aberration of what Muslim doctrine and the Quran says about the appropriate way to conduct conflict and what jihad really is all about. Because jihad is not a holy war, and it is not a violent encounter against other people. At its source, it is a striving for the maintenance of righteousness and spiritual wellness in the individual. And so You know, one of the things that has characterized perhaps the American fear that we've talked about is this whole notion of jihad and terrorism, whereas the Quran speaks openly about the fact that terrorism is a sin. It is unrighteousness. It is an aberration to God. And in that context, regardless of what the religious basis is for how these groups identify themselves, I think it's important to understand that it's an aberration of what true Islam really espouses.
Thank you, Kevin. If this talk has initiated a conversation that has excited some interest in you, let me announce some upcoming events that are taking place at UNB that you might like to take part in. First of all, on February 20th and February 23rd, there will be two events held at UNB. One will be a Welcome to New Brunswick event at UNB, and there will be details to come. The event on the 23rd will be an information session on inside the resettlement process, how refugees come to Canada, and there will be details on that as well. I'd also like to let you know that two panels presented by the Atlantic Canada Studies Centre will be held, the first one on February 16th, which will be on the history of refugees at the Provincial Archives Exhibit Room from 7 to 9 p.m., that's February 16th, 7 to 9 p.m. at the Provincial Archives Exhibit Room, and a panel of people with refugee backgrounds will speak, followed by a Q&A. And then later, on March 1st, the Atlantic Canada Studies Centre will have a follow-up panel on the history of post-Second World War refugees, for example, immediate post-World War European refugees, Cold War refugees, Vietnamese refugees, and Central and South American political refugees. A discussion will be followed by Q&A, and there'll be more details about location and so forth. I'd also like to let you know that in this room, on February 11th at 7 p.m., the internationally celebrated journalist and author Gwyn Dyer will be presenting a public free lecture. He will be presenting the annual Dominic S. Graham Memorial Lecture, and the title of his talk is Don't Panic, But You Can Worry a Little. And the talk will be on the Islamic State, terrorism, and the Middle East. So if you can't get enough, come back on February 11th here at 7 o'clock to hear Gwyn Dyer speak on that topic. It's been such a pleasure to host this evening's event. I would like, on behalf of the Gregg Center, to extend thanks to the Multicultural Association of Fredericton, the City of Fredericton, the Office of the President of the University of New Brunswick, and I personally would like to thank, on all of our behalf, the Gregg Center for organizing this wonderful evening. Thank you very much. Also, on behalf of all of us assembled, thank you so much, Kevin and David, for your thoughts this evening. Thank all of you for your attendance, your thoughts, your comments and questions. That's it for the evening. There will be we can gather afterwards. So thank you, merci, and wallywong. Good evening.